like to present you some methodological aspects of my PhD thesis with a focus on network analysis. In my thesis, I studied Central European Middle Neolithic assemblages, or more precisely, assemblages of the so-called cultural complex Hinkelstein-Grossgartach Roessen. That dates approximately to the first half of the 5th millennium BC. In my PhD thesis, I summarized this term as source Southwest German Middle Neolithic. On this map, you see the maximum distribution of this cultural complex. This shows the concentration of sites in Southwest Germany. From the elbow of the Rhine, here, to the Harz and Steigerwald and the Rhineland. The focus on my PhD thesis was on assemblages from northwestern Bavaria, more precisely from the fertile loess soils around the river Main, which was densely settled during this time. One focus of my thesis was to develop a more precise chronological framework for this region that could be compared to neighboring regions for which this precise chronological framework already exists. So far, chronological studies of the Central European Middle Neolithic have been based on correspondence analyses. However, the results were usually not satisfactory. Therefore, I developed an analytical approach based on network analysis in order to solve the existing problems. In this context, I use network analysis not in the classical sense, as social or as we heard here, network analysis, but rather for studying chronological relations. First of all, I want to show you some characteristic pots from this period, since this is the basis for the analysis I want to present to you. The pottery of Southwest German Middle Neolithic is characterized by a complex system of decoration, you can see here, which is organized in horizontal zones. Above, you see the classification scheme developed by Helmut Spatz in the 1990s for the Middle Neolithic in the Neckar area. Below, you see the classification scheme developed by Anthony Lemaire for the Alsatian pottery. The decoration can be further differentiated not only by its morphology, but also by the type and technique of strokes. According to the classification scheme of Spatz, more than 1,500 motifs and variation of these motifs can be differentiated. This high number makes clear that, concerning chronological studies, the Middle Neolithic pottery is particularly suitable for statistical analysis. For my own analysis, I gathered data from the Middle Neolithic sites in my environment. For reason of super-regional comparison, I also collected data from literature, as for example, Middle Neolithic assemblages from the Neckar region here, the southern part of Lower Saxonia, and the famous Middle Neolithic cemetery of Trebur. In the end, my database consisted of 8,877 pottery sherds with about 14,900 attributes that could be used for quantitative analysis. In the first step, I used correspondence analysis for my chronological studies. As you can see here, the correspondence analysis of the complete dataset, including all regions mentioned before, shows a parabola-like figure. This result can be interpreted as a chronological sequence. However, as Spatz stated already in 1996, the younger part cannot be interpreted in a chronological way, since two different types of vessels, the so-called Roessen bowls and the so-called Kugelgefäße, that actually existed at the same times are sorted one after another. This sorting effect is caused by the strict rules of decoration for the Roessen bowls. They regularly are decorated with a combination of chevron band, crotch filling, and side ornaments. As you see here. Therefore, the similarity among the Roessen bowls themselves is higher than between the Roessen bowls and the Kugelbecher vessels. The latter are only rarely decorated with chevron band. As a consequence, the bowls cluster in the final part of the CA, while the Kugelgefäße lie in between the bowls and the other units. Therefore, a detailed chronological interpretation of the CA is not possible. In earlier publications, Spatz and other colleagues tried to solve this problem by separation of the hole margins. In a first step, they analyzed the earlier Middle Neolithic sherds, in a second step, the Roessen bowls, and in the third step, the Kugelgefäße. Subsequently, the results were combined on the basis of typological arguments. When I started my chronological analysis, I also used this approach. As you can see here, the analysis of my data did not result in a parabola shape. For the earlier part of the Middle Neolithic period, which you can see on the left here, only the end of the sequence yield a reasonable structure. However, the chronological order runs from the right side to the left here, which is vice versa that you would expect. When you look at the Roessen bowls down there, you can only see amorphous cloud of dots. I have to admit that it was a bit of a surprise to me to realize that in all studies of the Middle Neolithic pottery that were published before, the division into chronological stages was based on results quite similar to those on this slide. In order to understand how these already published chronological schemes were constructed, I had a closer look on the definition of each stage by simply counting the motifs per stage. This resulted in tables like the ones you can see on this slide. Or this slide. As you can see, for example, there are 10 motifs for Hinkelstein 2 and early Grossgartach, 8 motifs for Hinkelstein 2 and frühe Grossgartach, 4 motifs for middle Grossgartach A and Hinkelstein 2, and 7 motifs are restricted to Hinkelstein 2 and therefore can be interpreted as light motifs, defining the stage. But there are also stages which do not exhibit a single leitmotif or only a small number of those. For the earlier part of the Middle Neolithic, as defined by Hermann Spatz, this applies to the early as well as the late Grossgartach. For the earlier part of the Middle Neolithic, as defined by Anthony Dunaire, this applies to the stages Grossgartach 4 and Planig-Friedberg. This also goes for the other studies on the Middle Neolithic pottery and leads to the question whether chronological stages with any leitmotif can be defined as such. A closer look at the definition of chronological stages in the CA of Spatz for the Neckar area or Eisenhower for the Wetterau shows that the boundaries between stages were not always placed within gaps in the CA, like here or here, but rather arbitrarily. Both authors admit that their definition of chronological stages aimed at an evenly distributed number of motifs per stage, since they did not consider the methodological preconditions of the CA, these chronological frameworks lack the necessary empirical basis. Taken together, the results of the CA for the Middle Neolithic was not really satisfying, and other approaches with multivariate statistics were not successfully either. Therefore, I decided to try a new analyse. In this context, I came across social network analysis. To understand my new approach, first some very basic explanations. I think you all know this. In social network analysis, in proper sense, the relation between individuals or social units are analyzed. So the approach is so-called sociometry. In the structure of data, this is important now, is the so-called sociometrics. The actors are plotted in lines and in colors. The value of each cell shows whether there existed any relation between the actors and how strong the relationship was. So, here for example. Remembrance. Currently in ancient studies, network analysis is usually used to analyze spatial and social phenomena, as is also reflected by the talks in our session today. Studies on spatial network analysis in Central European literature are, for example, Martin Fuhrholz's analysis of the funnel beacon networks or Erich Klaassen's analysis of LDK networks of the Rhineland. My approach differs from these approaches since I use network analysis for analyzing chronological relations. I interpreted the combination of various elements of decoration on a pot or within a feature, like a pit or a grave, as a network. I switched the network from a spatial or sociological into a chronological dimension. Therefore, I called my approach Chronological Network Analysis, abbreviated as CNA. To explain my approach, we have to have a closer look on the databases that is usually used for CNA. Those data are usually presented as abundance tables or rather contingency tables. In the lines, you usually find the attributes, in our case various elements of decoration. In the columns, you find units, in our case vessels or features like pits or graves. In the cells are filled with the abundances. In the first step, I had to convert the databases into a social matrix, as we seen before. This can be done by a simple arithmetic operation from matrix algebra. The value of cells from the abundance table have to be multiplied line-wise and sum up column-wise, and the result is then entered in the corresponding cell of the social matrix. This arithmetic operation is the scalar product of the abundance matrix. For the analyses, we now have to calculate a matrix for the attributes as well as one for the units. A social matrix can be depicted also as a so-called network graph, where the nodes are the actors and the lines are relations, the nodes. At the next step, I tested my idea with simple data. I started from an ideal abundance table with 10 columns and 10 lines and 3 links. If you analyze this data set with CA, you unsurprisingly get a parabola. If we assume a chronological sequence for this parabola, the time gradient would run along the parabola. We also have to consider that the parabola is bent in the third dimension. Consequently, the gradient has to be interpreted multidimensionally. With real data, this often in literature causes problems in interpretation. You know. On the right side, I have transferred the abundance table into a social matrix by the use of this parabola, as described before. If we depict this chronological network as a graph, which you can see below, we get the following picture. We see a linear ladder-like structure. The time gradient runs linear. Unlike the CA, we do not have any boundary effects and no arch effect and so on. The strength of the ties between various attributes, which reflects the chronological closeness, is comprehensible through the line width. From this, we can infer that the algorithm works with test data. At next step, I analyze my data from Middle Neolithic assemblages with this new approach. Here you see, I hope this will run. Here you see my network of decoration motifs in a random order. Now, employing the algorithm Force Atlas by Jacomi, that is based on the simulation of physical forces, the network graph is drawn. As you can see now, we get 3 clusters, which correspond to the stages Hinkelstein, Grossgartach, and Roessen. For the Roessen cluster, we get a division into 2 parts, one here and one here, which corresponds to the bowls and the kugelgefäße. In contrast to the result of the CA, I showed you at the beginning of my talk, this division into 2 runs along the timeline. We do not get the sorting effect as in the case with correspondence analysis. Consequently, chronological network analysis constitutes a solution to this problem. Moreover, network analysis offers access to a broad spectrum of methods that allow analyzing network structures. There are, of course, the standard parameters, for example, the centrality values and measurements. For my analysis, I applied modularity analysis that describes the density of relations within groups or subgroups in comparison to the relation between groups. Subgroups identified by modularity analysis can be interpreted as chronological stages. Consequently, with modularity analysis, I have an empirical device for the subdivision of chronological stages. So, here we have the stages. Roughly speaking, A1 and A2 is Hinkelstein, B0, B1, B3 and B4 is Grossgartach, and C1 and C2 is Roessen. As you can see, B0 and B4 are only rarely a poorly identifiable. Moreover, there's a subgroup, B2, here, within this Grossgartach cluster that cannot be interpreted in a chronological sense. Since an interpretation as regional subgroup cannot be justified, the clarification has to remain an open question. Network analyses on the basis of features, maybe it works, revealed further interesting duct details. First of all, we have a closer look on the drawing of the graph. You can see on this slide. Modularity analysis show stages, the groups mentioned before, BO and B4, now are clearly definable. This result would not have been possible with correspondence analysis. What is still missing for this fact, however, is an archaeological interpretation for this phenomenon. I don't know. Let me start. The chronological network analysis allows for an analysis of all attributes and units, either shards of archaeological features like pits or graves of the Southwest German Middle Neolithic period. Modularity analysis allows for the development of a chronological sequence on an empirical basis. The results show differences between the analyses of pots and pits. In general, chronological network analysis is also a useful approach for other issues of relative chronology, for example, in connection with social differentiation or differentiation between gender. Finally, I would like to discuss a problem that I realized only lately. Actually, I call my approach chronological network analysis, as I mentioned before, in short, CNA. The problem is that this abbreviation is already used for various other network analysis approaches, as a quick search on Google showed. You can see the results on the slide. Therefore, I'm searching for another abbreviation, or maybe one of you has an idea. I would be grateful for your suggestions. Thank you for your attention, and I'm looking forward to your questions.